find myself to come up this morning.
All right, brother.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
I thought about a conversation me and Trina had in the church, from where church this morning. And she said, wouldn't my daddy, Reverend Gilstrap, be proud of me that I married a preacher man? And I thought, I said, well, wouldn't my dad be proud of me? And I thought about the song that says, when everyone around me could only see the worst in me, he saw the best in me. And God is that same way. When everybody around you only sees the worst in you, God can see the best in you. Growing up, I heard people talk about the book of Revelations, how they didn't particularly like to read it because it had all the doom and gloom in it, how it had so much death and destruction in it. And though people tend to look at Revelations rather pessimistically, but I, on the other hand, tend to look at it with a bit of optimism, as God has given us an opportunity to get it right,
that's all right,
if you don't have it right already. In the book of Revelation, starting with chapter 21, verses 10, it gives a vivid picture of what heaven will look like. It describes the high walls and the 12 gates with angels on each one. Each gate had the name of the 12 tribes of Israel, and each foundation has the names of the apostles on them. Its streets are paved with gold, has everlasting light, and that light is Jesus Christ. In our Thursday morning Bible study, the question came up as to whose names are on the gate. Now, some theologians and educators ponder whose names are written on the gate. Is it Judas, who betrayed Jesus, who was one of the original disciples? Or was it Matthias, who replaced Judas, but you never hear him mentioned again in the Bible? Or was it the Apostle Paul, who wrote almost half of the books in the New Testament? In Revelation 21:27, which reads, but there shall by no means enter anything that defiles or causes an abomination or a lie, but only those who written in the Lamb's Book of Life. My text this morning is, but only those who are written in the Lamb's Book of Life. I like the title of this sermon, is Your Name on the Roll. I'd like to talk to you a few minutes this morning on, don't worry whose name is on the roll. Just make sure, don't worry whose name is on the gate. Just make sure your name is on the roll so that you can get in the gate. We live in a society and culture that has become name crazy. Some people live their entire lives based on what's in a name. They have to buy name brand clothes from name brand stores. They won't get caught dead buying something from Kmart, Walmart, or Target, as if what you're wearing would make a difference as to who or what you are. Some people have to buy brand name furniture, as if what you're sitting on or sleeping in makes a difference as to what or who you are. And still, there are those people who will only buy brand name food. But there are millions of people around the world will be glad to get some food no matter whose name is on it. If the brand name is not on it, then we don't want it. We tend to live our lives simply to impress the people around us. Some people think because they wear fine designer label clothes, that means something. Don't get me wrong. There's nothing wrong with wearing fine clothes. If God has blessed you with the ability to have the finer things in life, that's good. But know that those labels won't get you in the gate if your name is not on the road. The name on the car you drive won't get you in the gate if your name is not on the road. Now, God may have blessed you to have accumulated a certain amount of wealth, and that's good. God never meant for everybody to stay poor. But the big faces on the names and them bills in your account, in your bank account, that won't get you in the gate if your name is not on the road. There are some people who wear brand name shoes. Got to have them. But the name on them shoes, they won't walk you. Told us what's not going to get us in the gate.
Yeah.
Now tell us what will get us in the gate.
All right.
How do we get our name on the road?
All right.
I'm glad you asked.
Yeah.
Thank you. Thank you.
All right.
It is so simple. Simply start by saying, Lord.
Lord.
I yield. I surrender all.
Yes, sir.
Surrender to the will and the ways of God.
Yes.
Allow God to order your steps and direct your path in life. Now, as humans, it's hard for us to totally submit to the will of anybody. We don't want to give up 100% control for no reason. But as the song says, 99.5% just won't do it. Now, I remember growing up, going to church and social circle, and they used to sing an old-time song.
All right.
Get right with God.
Okay.
And do it now.
All right.
Get right with God.
Yeah.
He will show you how.
All right.
Down at the cross where he shed his blood. Get right with God. Get right with God. Because the price for admission into that gate has already been paid. It was started on a hill called Calvary. On an old rugged cross. This cross was not made from precious metal or adorned with red stone. It was covered in the precious blood of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. The price for admission was stamped paid in full 3 days later, early on Sunday morning, when our Lord and Savior got up from the grave in a tomb that had somebody else's name written on it. He got up with all power in his hand, so that our name can be on the roll. Make sure that when the roll is called up yonder, that your name has a line under it and not a line through it. All right. Woo. There is one gate, and that's a straight one, which is the Lord Jesus Christ. His person, his blood, his righteousness and his regenerating and sanctifying grace, for he is the only door into heaven. Liberty is your name on the road this morning.